Kronecker's limit formulas. So I'm assuming you're familiar with this picture. I'm drawing the tau plane, where tau is the complex structure of a torus. So tau is acted upon by SL2z, which is generated by these two transformations, T and S. Under the T transformation, a point here is mapped to a point here, so this can be identified. And under this transformation, this region here is mapped to this region here. And in fact, the definition of a fundamental domain is like the word lagom in Swedish. This means just enough. That means that every value of tau is covered exactly once by using just this fundamental region here. We often say that in closed string theory, there are no ultraviolet divergences because they would be down here for very small tau 2. And what that means is I can choose this fundamental region where there's only infrared divergences for large tau 2. So it's a justified question, what does that mean if you have this symmetry? To be a little bit more specific, we have to talk about which specific functions on the upper half plane are we actually interested in. One way to make this more concrete is to do what we do in quantum field theory, put an ultraviolet cutoff. So very short distances, tau 2. And there's a lot of mathematics of considering functions that don't decay close to I infinity, which is called the cusp. But notice that this straight line here, this sharp cutoff, this is not a geodesic in the upper half plane with the usual upper half plane metric. So one alternative could be using mass as an infrared regulator or as a UV regulator in Pauli-Villar. It's a standard method in quantum field theory for a paper by myself, Brinkman and Gannon. Maybe it could be also relevant in string theory. But that was a side comment. Let's go back to basics. A typical classical object like a theta function, you can plot the absolute value of theta 3, and you see that it's very complicated down here. Let's zoom in. You see this fractal-like structure close to the real line. So you see that this UV cutoff behaves very non-uniformly with respect to this behavior of the theta function. Another way to visualize this structure is to go to this variable, q, and you get this beautiful pattern, and the mathematical code for this picture is actually on the help page for the theta function. And there's actually a very nice exercise about this in Polchinski 7.5c, where he asks, does the behavior of the theta function close to the real line depend on whether the real part of the direction in which I take a limit to the real line is rational or irrational? This is one reason why number theorists find this interesting. So now we introduce an object that's closer related to theta functions, which is the Kronecker-Eisenstein function, also known as the Kronecker-Eisenstein series. There's conditional convergence at s equals 1. This phase looks unfamiliar to some people, so let me also write it in real variables. Introduce w is u plus tau v. So this object is quasi-periodic in z, which you can think of as the puncture on the torus. This double term only converges absolutely for real part of s greater than 1. The standard way to regularize is the heat kernel method. Here we'll use a slightly less common method, which I can call the twist regularization. This regularization is sufficient for the zero-point amplitude, the partition function, but it's also used for amplitudes, as we'll see. So let's review how to compute the partition function using functional determinants. So it's a standard quantum field theory exercise. So you can formally write this as a product of eigenvalues, this operator. Imagine acting on some basis functions. As I did before, in terms of real variables, u and v, these are the quasi-periodicities of these basis functions. And I remind you that my twist w, I can think of it as a regularization, so even if you're not interested in orbit folds, this could be a smart thing to do. Some physicists still have the feeling that this is somehow poorly defined, but to some mathematicians, this is easier to understand than our creation and annihilation operators, in particular the Quillen norm of a canonical holomorphic section of the determinant line bundle, as discussed, for example, in this beautiful book, Eisenstein series and automorphic representations. So what is the action of this operator on this basis function? If you just focus on this part of this eigenvalue for now, when we express this in momentum space, we say this is 1 over p squared to the s. But the power tau 2 doesn't quite seem to match. The theta function transforms under the s transformation. So mathematicians like to consider what's called Jacobi forms. And the theta functions are elementary examples of Jacobi forms. And from that point of view, the naive Laplace operator, this one, is not invariant. So doing that here, this is what you have. And notice, to do the free inversion, you need to have some basis functions to start with. But now we have this tension here that the object we're interested in has s equals 0, and we only have a representation for s greater than 1. So this is where the reflection formula comes into play. So the reflection formula for the Kronecker-Eisenstein function, this object, is this. But notice that these arguments switch here. So what had a clear interpretation as an orbifold twist and a marked point on the torus are now switched. So if you exponentiate this to get rid of the log, you have this expression. Now if I set w equal to this expression, which just relates the u and the v here to the more conventional beta and alpha, then I have a relation of this to e1, what Kronecker's second limit formula tells me, can then be related to a theta function. And rewriting theta 1 in terms of theta with characteristics, this is the standard expression for the partition function of a holomorphic anti-holomorphic fermion pair. But the key tool here was this reflection formula. So here we'd like to prove this reflection formula. As a warm-up, let's just do the reflection formula for the Clausen function, which is the real or imaginary part of the Pauli logarithm, which in itself is the generalization of the Riemann zeta function, to which it reduces if you set z equals 1. Let's take the original theta function, theta 3, which is this sum representation, and following Riemann's original paper on the Riemann zeta function, let's use a Mellin transform. The standard Mellin transform of this function is the gamma function. We can apply the Mellin transform to this object. Turns out it diverges, but if we subtract the 1, we get a well-defined expression. So if you're interested, please take a look at my Mathematica file next to this on my video list webpage. This is not really an integral representation of the Pauli logarithm itself, because the two terms have different argument, but it can be thought of as an integral representation for the Clausen function. In other words, you can think of this integral for any complex S. In Riemann's original paper, as I said, he has z equal 1, but what he did is to then split up the integral into 0 and 1 and 1 to infinity and use the S transformation property of the theta function. By the way, to really get Riemann's calculations from this, you need to be a little bit specific about how you take this limit. If this is completely new to you, you might feel slightly more comfortable with this formula on Wikipedia, which instead of the Pauli log, writes the Hurwitz zeta function. Just like a Pauli log, it doesn't really have a reflection formula in the sense of the Riemann zeta function or this expression. For rational arguments, z, it does have a reflection formula to a finite sum of Hurwitz zeta functions. This was an aside where I discussed how an integral representation for the Clausen function gave a reflection formula. And now let's do it for the actual Kronecker-Eisenstein function. I first write a Mellin representation function. Just go ahead and check that this simple integral using this relation gives you back the double sum representation for ES. Now, just like in Riemann's original paper, we have a possible problem here at zero. So what we do is split off the 0 to 1 part and do a Poisson resummation, which is equivalent to doing an S transform in a theta function. I can now change the integration variables to 1 over t. So this is all for the 0 to 1 part. Now we have two terms in this interval. We have the original piece and the transform piece, and there's no zero lower limit anymore. Now we see that for S goes to 1 minus S, this is simply replaced by this. And these two things are now exactly the same. So you flip S and 1 minus S, generate this factor. So in other words, just staring at this for a little bit, you see this reflection formula. You can really perform this integrals numerically if you want. If you allow W or Z to be, for example, 0, there are pole terms at S equals 0 and or S equals 1. And this is discussed in Siegel's theta lectures or in our appendix in this paper. The final punchline was that Kronecker limit formulas helped us compute the fermion partition functions. But hold on, didn't you start with the Laplace equation? Yes, so the bosonic partition function should also be contained in this calculation. But if you really have doubly periodic bosons, there's a slight subtlety, as I said in the beginning, has to do with the zero modes. Because of the conditional convergence due to this non-zero, you can't use that if both W and Z are zero, so you have to be careful about really keeping this epsilon here. This calculation is done, for example, in Nakahara's book. You have a pole term in epsilon. Just like I said here, if W or Z are zero, they can be pole terms as S equals zero, S equals one. These are regularization-dependent constants. We recognize that if we now exponentiate this, and remember bosons give the inverse of this, we get this for a fermion pair, holomorphic, anti-holomorphic. Or if we took 24 bosons, like in the bosonic string after ghosts cancel two of them, we get this familiar partition function. So to summarize Kronecker's second limit formula, we get the fermion partition function, possibly with spin structures, corresponding to my W parameter. Or for W equals zero, we get the partition functions of W periodic bosons on the torus. For amplitudes, this also helps with Green's functions. It's amazing that Kronecker and Riemann in the 1800s did things that are exactly the things we need to compute loop amplitudes.